graduate vocal ensemble. We are excited to share with you three selections from composer Dan Forrest, as well as some historical repertoire to trace Tertian relationships that are such a large part of his compositional voice. Dan Forrest is an acclaimed composer and arranger known for his choral, instrumental, orchestral, and solo music. Since his first publication in 2001, his pieces have become firmly established in the repertoire of choirs in the U.S. and abroad, and he has sold millions of copies of his work. Dan Forrest was born in Elmira, New York, in 1978. He started piano lessons in the fourth grade and served as a pianist in his church in the sixth grade. As a high school student, he composed and arranged several songs for piano. After he discovered choral music in college, he became serious about composing. He received a Bachelor of Music degree in 1999 and a Master of Music degree in 2001, both in piano performance from Bob Jones University. It was during his college years that Forrest became infatuated with recordings of choral music and what a choir could achieve musically. In 2007, he earned his Doctorate of Musical Arts degree in composition from the University of Kansas. He was a professor and chairman of the music theory and composition area at Bob Jones University from 2007 to 2012. He left his academic post to become a full-time composer as his compositions and arrangements became increasingly popular. Forrest works as an assistant editor at Beckenhorst Press. His music is in print with numerous publishers and is established in the repertoire of choirs all over the globe. His commissioned works have been performed in major venues around the world, including Carnegie Hall in New York City, the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C., Lincoln Center, and Izumi Hall in Osaka, Japan. Forrest seeks the opportunity to give people beautiful music and minister to them spiritually through his compositions. Forrest's music is based on his belief that all good things, including any beauty that we encounter, are from God, through God, and ultimately to God. Forrest glorifies God by creating music that invokes a spiritual listening experience for the listener. I first encountered Dan Forrest's music at a Henshaw music reading session in 2010. Most of the people in the room were choral directors looking for new publications that would benefit their choirs. Andre Thomas, David Childs, and Dan Forrest were a few of the composers there to introduce some of their music. We looked at a piece called Venite Adoremus, and this young man got up to talk about his composition. He spoke of the way he used the Cantus Firmus, Adeste Fidelis, the tune we know as O Come All Ye Faithful, and used fragments and inversions in retrograde to create his own version of the Cantus Firmus. I was quite impressed with his theory knowledge and humble demeanor. We sight read through the song somewhat successfully, and I loved it. After that, I knew Dan Forrest would be a composer I would not forget. One summer, one of my friends, Jacob, was opening a packet of choral music he would be singing with his bel canto group. I saw Dan Forrest's name on one of the pieces and said, "That one will be your favorite." Sure enough, he contacted me later and said, "I was right." That piece was Forrest's Requiem for the Living. I heard a recording of Jacob's bel canto group performing the Requiem, and I loved it too. Because he is a relatively young composer, little research has been done on his music or compositional style. After hearing the Requiem for the Living, I decided to do an analysis of the entire 5-movement, 40-minute work for my Master's in Theory thesis. The framework for discussion in that research extracts the importance of the number 3 in the primary motive, and draws connections to other aspects of the work that utilize 3 as an organizing mechanism. This number is evident in the range of the primary motive, the secondary motives, the 3-part formal design of each movement, the numerous mediant harmonic relationships, and the extended tertian harmonies. To expound upon this research, my current work examines 3 additional choral pieces by Forrest through the lens of these compositional techniques. The first song we will be singing is Forrest's setting of the Venite Adoremus text, translated, "Come Let Us Worship." He uses carefully constructed small motivic fragments of the traditional Adeste Fidelis hymn tune. The use vocatus firmus, a term particularly associated with the music of the medieval and Renaissance, is a device that designates a pre-existing melody used as a basis of a new polyphonic composition. The cantus firmus melody can be taken from plain chant or monophonic secular music, from one voice of a sacred or secular polyphonic work, or it may be freely invented. Composers in the Renaissance worked with motives as the smallest units of musical construction. They could create songs or movements which consisted of chains of interlocked phrases, each of them devoted to the manipulation of a single motive. Venite Auremus opens with Forrest's version of the theme. The intervals, contours, and little melodic motives are virtually developed from the traditional tune in one way or another. The a cappella imitative eight-part texture builds to a climax, at which point the full melody of the refrain of the traditional hymn tune enters and floats over the rest of the choir. This piece is one of the few compositions by Forrest that contains no key changes. Consistently in D-flat major, Venite Auremus contains no accidentals, remaining diatonic throughout. However, the simplicity of diatonicism does not mean it is an easy piece to sing. The a cappella, eight-part, often polyphonic texture creates a challenge. The harmonies in this composition include Tertian chords like major and minor sevenths, ninths, elevenths, and a large portion of the chords are triads, often with added chord tones like fourths, sixths, or ninths. The three-part form of Venite Auremus is sectioned by text, themes, and tempo changes. Only the Venite and Adeste themes are found in the two A sections in an adagio tempo, while the contrasting B section contains a faster tempo and unique themes that are used only once. We will now sing Venite Auremus.
Thank you.
formal designs, harmonic structure, and key relationships. The majority of the focus of my research is on forest harmonies and key relationships. Mediant harmonies refer to the use of triads whose roots are a third apart, but can be moved smoothly due to the existence of common tones between the two given chords. Two triads are said to exhibit a chromatic mediant relationship if they are both major or both minor and their roots are a third apart. Chromatic mediant chords were rarely used during the Baroque and classical periods, though the chromatic mediant relationships were occasionally found within a section of music, specifically some instrumental works by Mozart, Haydn, and Beethoven. Mediant chords and key relationships became much more common during the Romantic period and became even more prominent in post-Romantic and Impressionistic music. One of the earliest examples of a chromatic mediant relationship is found in Renaissance composer William Byrd's Sanctus from Mass for Four Voices. The Sanctus begins in F minor and cadences to the dominant, C major, in measure 14, following the three repetitions of the text Sanctus. Then the next section, Dominus Deus Sabaoth, proceeds in A flat major. This chord change maintains a common tone, C, between the two chords. We will now sing Sanctus by William Byrd.
So
relationships began to really flourish, especially with composers like Schubert, Schumann, and Brahms. As their presence grew and their profile became more familiar, chromatic third relations gradually became an accepted and much exploited aspect of 19th century harmonic practice. One of Brahms' most individual qualities is seen in his manner of handling his themes. While adhering to the classical structure far more strictly than any of the great composers since Beethoven, he gave it new life by the ingenuity with which he presents his material in new aspects, and in particular, by the kind of modulations he prefers. Rather than moving by gradual and definite steps to a remote key, he often leaves out one or more of the sequence of steps by which the distant key would naturally be reached. Certain key relationships are used with evident affection, such as the transition to the mediant or the submediant of the key, both of which are Tertian relationships from the tonic. For example, his greatest choral work, Ein Deutsches Requiem, contains 7 movements. The first and last movements contain chromatic mediant modulations within them. The first movement begins in the key of F major, then modulates down a major third to D flat major, which is one of the most glorious moments in the movement, and then back to F major. We are singing the first portion of the first movement through measure 64 to demonstrate the 2 chromatic mediant key changes. We will now sing Brahms' Ein Deutsches Requiem, movement 1.
Thank you.
motivic development, harmonic transformations, and formal design. Forrest writes, quote, "I first encountered Jake Adam York's poem, Abide, when a friend sent me an article from New York Times Magazine memorializing his untimely death in 2012 at the age of 40. End quote. York is known for his poetry elegizing the martyrs of the civil rights movement in the U.S. The poem is part of his collection by the same title, published in 2012, and was inspired by a vinyl recording of Thelonious Monk performing the classic hymn, Abide With Me. Forrest's setting hints at that hymn and seeks to evoke a sense of Americana on a warm late summer evening. Inspired by York's direct manner of reading his own poetry, Forrest sets the most of the text in a homophonic and syllabic style, surrounding it with richer textures which envelop and embrace his own honest voice. The piece opens with the soprano singing Abide on G flat, and the alto and tenor and basses whisper Abide. Forrest explains, quote, "The whisper is almost ghost-like, from Jake Adam York after dying so young, like a whisper from his past still lingering in our present," end quote. The poem evokes feelings of a lost loved one still speaking to us. Abide contains Tertian relationships between chords throughout the piece. It begins with the sopranos on G flat as a pedal tone. The first complete chord is E flat minor in measure 4, a minor third below G flat, then passes through to C flat add 9, a minor third below E flat. There are many more of these examples of media relationships and extended Tertian harmonies. However, I would like to point out two enharmonic median modulations you will hear. One section with the key signature of G flat ends on an extended two chord, A flat minor 11, goes to the key signature of D major in measure 62, but starts on an extended three chord, F sharp minor 9, add 4. The chord changes are all descending by thirds. C flat to A flat and A flat to F sharp are diminished thirds, and F sharp to D is a major third. The key change from G flat to D is an enharmonic mediant relationship. The section beginning in measure 62 has an ambiguous tonal center, then changes to D flat major in measure 71. The C sharp in the tenor becomes the enharmonic D flat, while the basses move down by half step from A to A flat. The chord change from A to D flat is another enharmonic mediant relationship. Finally, the next to last section, which ends on a D major chord, has an F sharp, which becomes the enharmonic G flat in the soprano, alto, and bass parts, while the tenor moves up by half step from A to B flat to return to the original key signature in measure 102. This key change eventually ends with the material we first heard, creating a cyclic formal design. Abide is a three-part form. The first and last sections contain the opening ideas in the key of G flat major and the same tempo markings, slowly, quarter equals 60 to 63. The contrasting B section changes key signatures often with ambiguous tonal centers and tempo fluctuations, creating a restlessness in the music. We will now sing Abide.
Oh.
original hymn tune, Ein Festgebet, was composed by Martin Luther, leader of the Protestant Reformation. Many composers have set Luther's original text and tune in their own style, including Hans Leo Hostler, George Philipp Telemann, Johann Sebastian Bach, and Felix Mendelssohn, to name a few. Johann Sebastian Bach used the tune as the source for his Cantata 80. The final chorale is the Ein Festgebet tune in the soprano with a different text, which is the fourth verse of the hymn. We will now sing the final chorale from Bach's Cantata 80. Changes in A Mighty Fortress Is Our God are all Tertian relationships. Are you noticing the theme yet? The song begins in B-flat major and changes to the relative G minor in measure 59. In order to do so, Forrest harmonizes the final cadence of verse 2 with a 4-chord, E-flat, and a fermata. Passes to the 5-chord, F, then the third verse begins in G minor. Also, the chords used in this transition, E flat to G, are a immediate relationship. B flat is the common tone between the key changes as well as the chord changes. The overlapping melody is still in B flat major with the harmonic implications of G minor in the accompaniment, but in measure 68, the underlying accompaniment returns to B flat major. A piano interlude provides a transition to D major in measure 94, a chromatic mediant relationship to B flat. All of the key changes in this piece are Tertian relationships, and D is the common tone between them all. When asked why he is so fond of thirds, Forrest says, quote, "I just like them. They always feel a little magical to me. It's a way of getting to new tonal territory without necessarily moving to a closely related key, and yet it's so easy to get there because of all the common tones involved. In a song like A Mighty Fortress, I just set out on a journey to start in a lower tessitura and gradually gain intensity and brilliance of vocal tone, so traveling through a key scheme like that helps make it happen safely and clearly," end quote. There are three versions of a three-part rhythmic theme in A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. The first foreshadowed in measure 10 in the piano, and the second appears in measure 16 in the piano. A slightly different version of the three-part rhythmic theme begins in measure 96 in the right hand of the piano and continues through measure 115, providing an accompaniment that adds interest and momentum, while the Ein feste Werk Cantus Firmus appears in augmentation in all the voices. A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, as you guessed it, a three-part form containing four verses, but verse one is a solo and verse two gradually adds all the voices. However, both verses are in B-flat major and the tempo marking slowly quarter equals 80. Verse three begins in G minor in measure 59 and changes to B-flat major in measure 68 with a tempo marking with great intensity quarter equals 104. The final contrasting section contains verse 4 in the key of D major and a faster tempo, triumphantly quarter equals 124. The purpose of my research is to show aspects of Forrest selected compositions that utilize three as an organizing mechanism. The tripartite forms, the numerous mediant harmonic relationships, the extended tertian harmonies are present in each selection. Forrest brings attention to the text through formal design, motivic development, and harmonic transformations. The contribution of this study will allow conductors and performers to understand the details in the performance of Dan Forrest's music, as well as the historical development of tertian harmonic relationships. The role of the conductor is to ascertain as much insight to the music he or she teaches by understanding the composer and the techniques commonly used by that composer. The goal of this research is to provide a detailed source for conductors to understand Dan Forrest and his compositional voice. Dan Forrest's three compositions, Abide, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, and Venite Adoremus, are ironically in